crashing Willie's garage.
Ha!
Well, hello, Rondas. Season finale of Willie's Garage. George, we made it. We're here. This is the Alf fan show. I've watched Alf since I was a kid. George, this has been a journey for you watching for the first time. How are you feeling at the final episode here?
I guess I feel like the Igor to your Dr. Frankenstein.
Good.
And this show is the monster.
This show is the monster. What a monster it's been. We want to thank everybody who has watched along with us. I know a lot of people, this has kept them going through this very odd last 12 months. And it's been fun for me, marginally less so for George. But we can say we did it. This is an accomplishment. We've gotten through an entire season of recapping Alf, looking at the minute details of it, exploring all the wonderful Alf merchandise that's been produced over the years. And it's been a weird show, George. Been a really weird show.
It's been it's been fitting for the weirdness of this era.
Yes, I agree. So we don't know what will happen with season two. We're Paul Fusco is not on the show, and neither is Alf. But who knows? We got a long summer hiatus. He could decide to show up and pay us a visit, and then confetti will drop, and Willie's Garage will, I don't know, go off into the sunset. It'll be the happy ending that everyone wants. But we'll see. We'll talk about maybe our summer plans and what going forward at the end. But for now, we got a great Alf season finale to talk about and a stunning video that I wanted to show you, George.
Ooh.
Somebody from Europe messaged me and said, hey, why haven't you shown anything about Alf's hit single, Stuck on Earth? It was released as a 45 in Europe. It was big in Germany. It was big in Holland. And I was like, I don't know. I have a ton of Alf songs that were released. I have the Burger King records, all that. And I looked into it. Sure enough, there was a group, this guy Ben Liebrand, who was on the there's a Dutch radio show called Curry and Van Inkle. Curry and Van Inkle in the morning. And so they debuted the song, which was kind of a remixed dance version of clips from Alf season one. And it was so popular on the radio show that they put it out on vinyl, and it reached number 6 on the Dutch singles charts in 1988. So it was, you know, about a year after season one, I guess. I found that they released a music video for this, George, and it's more than just clips from the show. So here's the music video for Stuck on Alf. It's like a, you know, like all dance remixes, it's like 6 minutes, so I'm not going to watch the whole thing, but enough to get the idea.
Before you say another word, may I present to you Alf?
Now, a lot of people said that when they, just from what I saw on the internet, people in Europe were like, this is the first time I'd heard the American Alf, what he sounded like. They mostly had heard Tommy Piper, the German Alf, who had a gruffer voice. So, and I think they subtitle some of this in Dutch.
The show is on. Your eyelids are growing heavy. You are getting sleepy. You are no longer a cat. You are a bagel.
I want that mask.
Hey, you scared me. You ought to wear a bell.
What's going on here?
What happened here? I was just teaching Lucky how to tell time.
Flying window.
Show Willie what you've learned.
You were hypnotizing him, weren't you?
Okay, you caught us. I'm trying to help Lucky beat his smoking problem.
Wacky.
Just kidding!
Whoa. This is like Dutch Dope Joe Blevins made this, I think.
Well, my name is Alf, and I'm stuck on Earth. I can't get back to my place of birth. Making the best of a bad situation. Think of it as an extended vacation.
Hello.
Watch
is that you,
part,
Mr.
George?
President? Listen, I know you're a busy guy, so I'll make this brief. We've only got one planet, so why don't you and the Rusky ease up a little, will ya?
Goodness, that's pretty complicated.
Hope I haven't oversimplified the problem.
everything we can. Mr. Elf, we're sending someone around right now to follow up.
Very sure.
Just sit tight, okay?
You too.
Well, my name is Alf, and I'm stuck on Earth.
All right, that's,
I can't get back to my place of birth. No way. Making the best of a bad situation.
I mean, I can't stop watching.
Think of it as an extended vacation. Yeah. Well, my name
Look
is
Look at the flying windows.
I mean, I can't get back to my place of birth.
All right, that's enough. But what? I mean, how had I not seen that?
Wow, the 80s were so fucked up.
They really were, yeah. Especially in Europe. I mean, there's just things happening I had no idea about. So, wow. I mean, I have been saving that now for a few weeks to show in the final season finale.
I don't know how you were able to suppress
I know.
Showing it.
It's a celebration. It's a celebration of Elf. So let's get into a Melmac recap for the season finale of season one. Melmac recap. Okay, George, this one is called Come Fly With Me. It aired May 11th, 1987. So much happens in this episode. It's hard to recap the plot. We're going to be here all night. probably a dozen new locations and sets that had to be built. Just the full cast is involved, the Akmonics, there's new characters, there's exotic hotel rooms, there's a cargo plane involved. It is a tour de force. I think they just threw their entire budget into the season finale. I don't know if they knew if they were coming back at this point either.
Yeah, that's actually the sense that I got while watching it, was like they're going to try. They were just doing anything and everything.
Yeah. You'd think that, like, the you're the one that's out of this world music video they could have done for this episode, because it just, you know, that had everything too. But I guess they just tried to go full bore wacky plot. So what happens is that Alf thinks he has won the publisher's clearinghouse, which, talk about an 80s reference. That was, like, I feel like in everything. The thing where you'd get it in, you'd put the stamps of the magazines you wanted on, and you could be entered to win. Ed McMahon would hand you the check.
Yeah.
But Alf didn't win. He just, I guess, subscribed to a lot of magazines. So they're out in the garbage. The Publisher's Clearinghouse, does that still exist, do you know, George?
I think so.
Okay.
And I'll let you know in about, you know,
okay.
a few. But...
So that happens. But then also Alf is, you know, he's in a lot of harebrained schemes and get-rich-quick schemes. And I guess he signs up for a timeshare pitch where you get a free talking toaster. And you have to be pitched for... And you also get a free vacation to Rancho Estates and somewhere in Southern California. And it turns out Trevor Akmonic got the same letter to be part of this timeshare pitch. Let's watch that scene. You know, Trevor Akmonic is my favorite character, so.
Hey! You got a letter from Rancho Estates, too!
Oh, yeah.
I also like Trevor's shirts. I would wear that one today.
The toaster people. Yeah.
George, are you wearing a Trevor shirt right now?
This is a Trevor original. I'm actually disappointed. I thought you were going to be wearing a Brian shirt for the...
I wish I had that. I wish I had, like, his Bumstead shirt or... one that just said football or something, but...
But you are wearing an Alf shirt.
Yeah, I found this at a vintage store. It is Alf Capone.
Wow.
I'll show it on full camera, but let's get into this crucial
yes.
plot point of Trevor finding the...
Raquel and me, we go to these things all the time.
Hey, you want to go together?
Together? No, we're not interested. Well, because of me? No, I didn't mean that. We'd love to spend a weekend with you folk, but we're not interested in a 7-hour drive.
Oh, you can fly there in 1 hour.
Yeah, sure, but who could afford it?
I'll fly you there for nothing. My friend lets me borrow his plane on weekends.
You're a pilot?
Yeah, I flew in Korea. Over Incheon, I took some commie flak in my ribs. You want to see this car?
I want to talk about Korea with Trevor.
Trevor?
Then it's settled. See you Friday night after work at the airport.
What's settled? What airport?
Oh, thanks again for the garbage can, Trevor.
What garbage can?
This garbage can. And Trevor wants to fly us to Rancho Estates.
Way to go, Mr. O!
I just kept that in because that's kind of what I think every time I see Trevor on screen. I'm like, way to go, Mr. O. You really livened up the scene.
He has a lot of very memorable lines in this episode.
He does it. And have you ever had an experience with the timeshare thing? I feel like that was bigger in the 80s, but they still exist.
No.
It was the thing where, like, you could listen to a pitch and get a free trip or get a free steak dinner or, you know. I actually unwittingly got roped into one in college on a trip to Cancun for an academic conference.
Ooh.
It is a long story that I told one time on Risk, the Kevin Allison podcast, so you can listen to it there, or I'll post it on Patreon. I typed up the story last month, and I'll put it on. But basically, I thought myself a pretty savvy person, and I'm in Cancun. I wanted to go on an excursion, and I had to sit there and listen to a timeshare pitch, and I couldn't escape it. It was as bad as they portray on this episode. For some reason, the Akmonics, or the Tanners, decide to go on this trip with Trevor flying them in a cargo plane. Very convoluted. Only problem is they have to leave Alf at home. And they get to a very nicely appointed Rancho Estates hotel room. And then this happens.
Oh, hello, you must be the Tanners. I'm Bill Lohman, sales manager for Rancho Estates.
Did you find out who this guy was, George?
No. I'll see who
Bill Lohman was. Okay.
Expecting you. Oh, no, Mr. Tanner. I think you were expecting the hard sell.
He seems familiar.
Well, there's no need to worry about that. Good.
He kind of looks like Rich Hall, the Sniglets guy from...
Yes.
Not necessarily the news, but that's not Rich Hall.
Archie Hahn.
Okay. Does that ring a bell? Has he been in anything else we'd recognize?
Yeah, he seems to have... He has a lot of credits.
Okay.
You know, small parts and things.
Yeah. Okay, character actor.
Yep.
Good, because after you've seen this slideshow, you are going to be begging me to sell you a home.
Buenos dias. That means good day. And at Rancho Estates, every day is a good day.
Would it be okay if we looked at this later?
When later?
Much later.
Oh, absolutely. No problem. You know, you folks should first enjoy some tennis, some swimming, and some fishing. And if you need me, I'll be following you in a golf cart.
They're persistent. That's the joke.
You know, we expected a sales pitch.
You know, I always talk about Brian's shirts, but Willie wears a lot of these shirts that are long sleeve and the collar's built into them and it's a different color. Last week he had a green one. Now he's got the red one.
And it's the question whether or not there's actually two articles of clothing
yeah,
or whether it's a dickie.
That's usually the question, but with Brian's shirts. But I think it's unquestionably part of one shirt here with Willie.
Mm-hmm. We expected a sales pitch.
Yeah.
That's no reason why we still can't enjoy ourselves.
Alf! Buenos dias!
It turns out he's stowed away in Lynn's suitcase. Nobody noticed, apparently, that there was a 80-pound suitcase. I think it was Kate's suitcase, actually. And they continue on with this charade. The Tanners and the Akmonics go to dinner, and Alf is having fun with the talking toaster. I thought this was a fun scene, some kind of a fun set piece here.
Hello, room service. Send another bag of bread to room 13. Yeah, leave it outside the door again.
Those things.
Quiet, I'm on the phone. Oh, hey, and bring some tartar sauce. Thanks. Now let's see what you can do with catfish.
So obviously no studio audience because the pullback of the show, the POV shot,
they would have already seen.
The toast. Yes,
of course, yes. I'm always there are parts in like Family Matters where there's like a giant Urkel robot or something, and they're supposed to be a reveal, but the audience already knows. It's completely phony. don't know if I ever told the story, but one time me, Joe, and some other friends who came in to watch the Little Marky, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
We watched that found footage video, but we also had a friend that worked on Hope and Faith, the Faith Ford and Kelly Ripa sitcom that Megan Fox was actually on.
Hmm.
And man, I had never been, I've been to some late night talk show tapings, some game show tapings in my life, but a sitcom taping is just death. It is such a drag. We were there for, I want to say almost 4 hours.
Ooh.
Stopping and starting, rewrites happening on the fly. And there was just so much dead time while they were setting up for new scenes that the warm-up comic was just telling sincere stories about his son. At one point, they tried to... And basically, we were the only people there of our age. Everybody else was bussed in from Long Island and paid in free pizza and cookies. There's one woman who is at every single sitcom taping of this show, and she was wearing a pink matching sweatsuit. And I remember Joe getting mad because she hogged all the pizza. And I couldn't eat the pizza. Nothing was vegan. So I'm just starving. It's like dinner time. And at one point, I was like, we're going. I don't care. The next break, we're just going. And they got kind of mad at us, but I couldn't do anymore.
Right.
And Hal Holbrook was there, by the way, for that
ooh.
Episode. Yeah.
Oh.
Even that, I remember he was just phoning it in. There was one point where he was supposed to say, "We'll play a game of checkers. Strip checkers." And the way he said it was, "We'll play a game of checkers, strip checkers." Like, there was no pause, no comic delivery. I think he knew what he was getting into here.
Well, I know what our next recap show will be.
Hope and Faith. It was weird because they tried to... Megan Fox was, like, sexy, and they sexed her up. But then it was ostensibly a family sitcom. It was like 2 and a Half Men, where it was like, what is the audience here? Is it sex jokes, or is it about a little kid?
It's an empire crumbling. That's what
it was. You're right.
When all sense of society is ending.
Yes.
These sitcoms are what keep us going.
I agree. Well, turns out Alf did put catfish in the toaster. It starts a fire. The smell gets them kicked out of the hotel. And Trevor has to fly them home in his cargo plane. This time, he had pigs on the cargo plane on the way there. On the way back, he's picked up jackals. I mean, this is full-on wacky territory. So here's a little bit of the... I think Alf has to land the plane, and here's some of that.
Possibly the worst weekend of our entire lives.
You haven't stopped complaining since I burned down that room.
You, back with the jackals.
They're hyenas, and I don't like them.
They're jackals.
Then why are they laughing at me?
Pretty good line. But it gets weirder because then Trevor, he's eating shellfish at the dinner at Rancho Estates. It causes him to think he's still flying in Korea. Alf has to land the plane, and at one point he actually sings the title of this episode, "Don't Come Fly," or he sings "Come Fly with Me," and he lands the plane successfully. That's it. That's the end of a very wacky episode, season finale. What did you think of this season finale?
I didn't love it. But
yeah,
I was shocked by Trevor Achmanek saying with his line, "You look real sexy in that," to Kate when she borrows. That was one of the lines where, I mean, he could. I don't know. It just
his delivery is great. Yeah, because he borrows Mrs. Achmanek's dress. I think Kate does because her suitcase was filled with Alf, so she didn't have any clothes to wear. She wears. It was pretty funny to reveal. She wears. Total Mrs. Achmanek floral kind of housecoat style dress at dinner. And it was a weird ending to a weird show, a very weird show. And that's been my biggest surprise about season one of Alf is just how bizarre it is.
Yeah, I guess it did really well. I mean, like for a new show, it came in, I think, 15th for the year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And,
pretty good, and then it picked up steam, and obviously the merchandising really kicked in during the off season here. And I was picking up Alf merch as a kid, and in fact, I'm going to show one piece of Alf merch I had as a kid and still have in a very emotional Alf trap. Well, let me start off, George, by showing you more of this. The shirt I found at a vintage store. I was just in the East Village at a vintage store, and I found this Alf Capone shirt from a line of shirts that kind of use this art style, this sort of posterized art style, and you see the bullets in here, and then it says the Melmac Gazette Alf Capone Raids Refrigerator. So part of a line of shirts, and this they just happen to have this one there. The same vintage store, George, had a signed why am I forgetting his name? Game show host, flamboyant. He would throw confetti.
Chivalry.
He would throw confetti.
Rip Taylor,
yes. They had a green shirt with just sort of like a white line drawing of Rip Taylor on it, and then it was signed Rip Taylor on the shoulder.
Wow.
So I had the Elf shirt, and I'm like, that Rip Taylor shirt, how much is that? They go, not for sale. And I was like, I get it. I totally get it. You keep that one. It should be in a museum somewhere.
I love stories where you're among your people. Of
yes.
Like, just yeah. People look at the world the same way.
Well, let me talk about, so we have not been able to tour as a found footage festival, which has been our primary source of income, me and Joe on the main show. And it kind of made me nostalgic for touring. Now, we are going to be on tour again. I think next week we are in, we're going to be doing an outdoor show in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania at a place called Steel Stacks. It'll be fun, socially distanced show outdoors. But in the fall, we've started booking more shows. I don't know what they'll be like. I assume there'll be some sort of social distancing things in place, and masks will be happening, and we'll be vaccinated. Hopefully, everybody else will be. But I realized that there was a piece of elf crap that happened at a show in Danbury, Connecticut. I found this backstage. This is maybe 7 or 8 years ago, long before we were doing this show. It was an Alf, a lovely framed Alf picture. Take a look. So you can see that I think they had their first dollars there. This is at our venue backstage there. There's a CBGB handbill there. These look like fake dollars or maybe graffiti dollars. Framed Alf thing, a koala bear, somebody's senior picture maybe. And it made me nostalgic for weird backstage areas on tour. So hopefully in the fall we'll have more weird Alf things we'll find backstage.
Something to keep you going is hope.
Yeah. End in sight. Okay, George, what do you have?
I have some weird Garbage Pail Kids I don't quite understand. I don't know whether these are like sanctioned custom cards that like...
These look like maybe 30th anniversary, like limited edition.
Right, but I don't know whether... I don't think they're... I guess they're licensed because of that logo. But I find ones like, for instance, this one, Gorged Gordon, also exists as Fed Alfred.
Well, you know, they would always do an A and B.
Okay. Well, that explains...
They would always have the same art with different... Oh, okay.
It's Gorged on Gordon with Alien Life Norm.
Okay, yeah.
And finally, gorging on Garfield.
This does not look sanctioned.
Right. So that's why it's things like this that
Oh, GPK of... Customs. So I guess they would do custom ones for people?
It's a mystery.
I don't know why Garfield's brain is exposed.
This is a cliffhanger for season 2
of
Willie's Garage.
Okay, interesting Garbage Pail Kids. I like the Garbage Pail Kid art style. Okay, my friend Nick, who runs an Alt Weekly in Eau Claire, Wisconsin, where I went to college. I don't hear from him very often, but when I do, it's something good. This is Best Cycling Style Daily Pictures, and you can see wherever this person is, wherever this guy is, there's an Alf mural that, George, matches the Alf art from the tattoo you showed last time on Willie's Garage. Yeah.
Yeah.
So... Huh. This must have just been a popular still from Alf being on the phone, and it made its way onto a mural with, like, looks like an astronaut. I want to know where this is, because I feel like it's worth a pilgrimage wherever this is. I don't know where it is, but we tour a lot of places.
It is tagged, though, so maybe you can go on and get
the
location or the person to ask.
Okay, well, that's a field trip coming up later in the fall.
Wow. I have been showing Alf cakes for the last few months, and this week is no different. Here is an, you know, a sort of a jolly Alf.
Mm-hmm.
But I
don't. Long snout.
I don't think that is Lucky. I don't remember.
Lucky was white and black, but, you know, okay. I guess the marzipan only came in, or the fondant only came in one color.
Yeah, I don't know. How's
spilled coffee, spilled tea, maybe, and.
Oh, yeah. I didn't know what that was. I thought that was like some sort of ribbon that went awry. But yes, it looks like, huh. Well, would you eat it?
Absolutely.
Oh, no, it can't be vegan. Right?
Well, if it was, I would certainly try it.
Okay.
Yep, I would try any Elf cake. All right, here's the part where I'm going to get emotional because my dad, when I was a kid, got me a fake street sign that said Lighten Up Lane. It was Alf, and this was, I think, after Alf went off the air. I was in high school, and I had it up in my room, which is black and white, and I loved everything about my room. I got it to be exactly the way I wanted it to be, not unlike my room now. And I had this Lighten Up Lane sign. It was above my the door to come up, to go out from my room into the hallway. And I put it, it's still up above my sink right now. And rather than take it off, because it's kind of permanently glued there, I thought I'd show you a picture I took. This is my late bird, my Gloucester canary, Bort. And you can see he's sitting on the faucet there. I would just let him fly loose in the house. He would shit on everything. There's a lot of cleanup. But here he is with my Lighten Up Lane sign. And you can see that Bort had hair. He kind of, it looked like, that was black when I got him. He was a baby, and it was just looked like he had a black wig on, and then it turned blonde to match the rest of his feathers. But yeah, so there was Bort on a faucet right in front of Lighten Up Lane. My final piece of elf crap for this final episode of season one.
An emotional episode for an emotional series.
Certainly is. But what about a final elf tattoo? Do you have one of those?
Well, first we need to hear the Alf tattoo theme.
Why did I get me an Alf tattoo? What kind of trauma was I going through? Instead of Papa Smurf or Mr. Magoo, I got an Alf tattoo. Alf tattoo. I have to hide it in job interviews. And now I'm singing the Melmacian Blues. Because of my Alf tattoo.
The last episode, I went with the long version.
Okay. Well, this is this is actually the design for a tattoo, which I don't think I've shown previously.
No.
But what this means to me is that this may not currently exist on someone. So what I'd like you to do, Nick, is contemplate this as a full back tattoo.
I'm contemplating.
I don't know if you want to run this by your girlfriend.
No, I'm just going to get it.
Okay.
Like this. I think it's good artwork. I just think it would indicate that I'm part of a Harley David lifestyle that I just don't want to be a part of.
Well, I also, my main issue is I don't love the font.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. But I do like that kind of, you know, scroll, but it should have been a cooler font. I agree. Yeah. I don't mind the artwork though. Good artwork. We have seen so much elf crap over, I mean, let's do the math. 26 episodes plus a bonus episode, 6 pieces of elf crap. Well, how much elf crap are we talking here, George?
156 pieces from the 26 episodes.
You
so
didn't think we could do it. And I'm telling you, I've got more I'm sitting on if we ever get to do a bonus episode or season 2 or anything else. So we got tons more to go. Well, let's just talk about let's do a little debrief here. Get a little bullet point in here about how TV has changed.
Well, I was thinking a couple things about, you know, this was, I can tell in small ways how this was groundbreaking in its day, but TV is seasonal. So the next season, something that's groundbreaking is standard, and we're 35 seasons away. So I think that it's hard to view it. I have to try to get in the mindset of a kid then, or just a viewer then. And so there is a lot of talk about a reboot. I mean, and that's just my own personal talk about it.
There has been since like 2012, there were talks of Paul Fusco trying to reboot Alf. Yeah.
Right. And I think and I think I've described my idea for the series when it comes back, is Brian's now middle-aged. He's in his 40s. He's a single dad. He's a free-spirited goofball, having been raised by Alf, more or less. Now, it's Alf who is older and wiser. He's guilty. Willie's passed on. Now, Brian is trying to get his kids into all sorts of mischief, and Alf is trying to talk him out of it, sort of like a borscht belt comedian who's, put upon all the time. But there's the other thing is that since then, furries exist now. So Alf can actually go hang out in public with people. He can be out of the house in some limited situations. Anyhow, that's my reboot.
I like it. It sort of opens it up. Yeah, I do like that. I really do.
And the thing about it is it would have to air on something like Netflix or a premium cable station, because TV has changed. I was looking at the ratings. These are the current ratings for recent weeks. 60
it's
minutes
all old people stuff. Look at this. NCIS, Blue Bloods. No one under 60 watches any of these.
Right, and look at these numbers. The highest rated show is a 5.6. Now,
brutal.
Cosby, by comparison, had a 25.6. Alf was 15th with 17.5. Now, that apparently represents the percentage of television stations that are tuned to that show that exist at all. And I was
a Nielsen family. I was one of those people counting, but this was in like 2007. So,
right. Oh, so Alf was 10th let me see.
Oh, okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. So 10th by 87, 88.
Next season, yep.
Right, and 88, 89 was 15th. But these are, things. It's just a very different,
totally different world.
World. Yeah. I'm thinking, like, you get Netflix to make a Gen X dream come true and reboot one whole night's lineup from that era, like 4 to 6 episodes back to backs, 4 comedies, 1 drama. Because what we used to do, you'd sit there for 3 hours of the clip, sitting on the couch, eating full bags of Smart Food popcorn and Pepperidge Farm cookies, drinking Coke after Coke. Or maybe that was just me.
No, I was right in the same boat with you. Yep.
So Paul Fusco, it can happen again in a different way.
Well, and here's one idea. I just saw that Joel from Mystery Science Theater launched a Kickstarter. They want to make more episodes, so he's going to make his own network, basically, kind of like we have, with if they get to like $5 million on there. And so could we possibly, with Paul Fusco, do a Kickstarter for an Alf reboot that would just be, maybe it's not even on Netflix, maybe it's just on YouTube or some other, or its own network?
Yes. Yeah, I like it. I like the idea of Alf on the internet, on the show, so that he's like a famous internet recapper or unboxer or something.
Let me reach out, because and my idea for an Alf reboot is kind of an odd couple. So, Alf ends with this TV movie that was on a different network where Alf, none of the Tanners are in it. The military has got Alf. But I don't want to give away the ending, but he gets away at the end. But maybe he could end up living with Brian, like you were saying, but it's kind of an odd couple thing, where Alf is a little bit more of the button-up, neat freak, and Brian's kind of the slovenly jerk at this point. And I'd like to see that juxtaposition. It's kind of the fish-out-of-water thing, a role reversal thing. I don't know. I would like to see how that worked. But we'll leave it up to you, Mr. Fusco, and let's get this thing going. My other idea, George, for this summer that I'm going to spearhead is trying to get Alf and Paul Fusco a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. This is not something that's like voted on. It's just basically, if you can raise enough money, you can get somebody's star on there. It happened with Weird Al a couple of years ago. I think it needs to happen with Alf. I think if anybody's going to spearhead it, I think we are the ones to do it, George. This can happen. We can start an online petition. I think this is very doable, and I think, more importantly, would get the attention of Mr. Fusco, who then would come on Willie's Garage, ending your long national nightmare. What do you think? What do you think about that idea?
I love every part of that, especially that last part. That was
Well, I think we can get Joe Blevins maybe to make a theme song, like to get people to donate. We can get people to do some Alf art, because we have a lot of people who make art for our show. I think it could be this huge movement that has something to keep us going this summer.
Yes.
specifically keeps me going.
Right. Well, I'll put in the first dollar.
Okay, great. I think that, what was I going to say? Oh, also, season two, I feel like we got to at least cover it in some way. Whether that, you know, we did talk about on VCR Party doing a marathon of season two and maybe making it a fundraiser where you're just watching us watch it live. I don't know how that would work copyright-wise. I don't know how it, we'd have to take breaks to show some elf crap. But it's a
and
fun idea.
To take
idea.
Elf craps.
Yes, to take elf craps. It'd be a fun idea. I mean, Joe and I, we watched for 3.5 days, we watched every episode of Full House.
Oh, man.
It was crazy. We kept a little video diary. We watched 24 hours a day with only, you know, one person was watching at all times. We gave each other 2-hour naps where we got to sleep for just a little bit, but you could hear it on in the background. So it might be fun to do a live, almost like a telethon, an alphathon. I don't know how that would work copyright-wise because we'd be showing whole episodes, but maybe, I don't know. We'll have to figure this out, but maybe there's something to this. What did you think about that idea when we talked about it at a VCR party?
Oh, I wanted to get it all. It wasn't just I wanted to get it all out of the way, but I like endurance challenges, and that I couldn't do 3 days, but 26 hours. I can imagine myself taking an Uber home after that, like if it's done,
yeah.
if it's able to be done in the same place.
Or maybe we don't stream it live, but we document it live, you know, and then we edit those into episodes. I don't know. We'll figure it out. Let us know in the comments what you would like for that, or email me at nick@foundfootagefest. We could do a lot of stuff this summer.
Yeah.
All right. What did you have something in here about reruns, George?
Oh, well, just that the summer was all reruns, except for Bob Hope's High Flying Birthday Extravaganza, which was I believe it was the 50th birthday of the Air Force, maybe 60th.
It's weird to me that they're still doing Bob Hope specials in the late 80s.
Well, here's a still from, I don't know if this is from it, or because most of these people appear on it. But, I mean, how 80s is this photo?
Phyllis Diller, Kirk Cameron, Emmanuel Lewis Webster, Ronald Reagan, and Bob Hope.
Lucille Ball. And it also had pretty good ratings. It had like an 18.5, which, again, that's like three and a half times what any show now, the highest rated show now would get.
I guess, I mean, people, Alf. I guess just like old people watch TV at all times. They were a big block of TV viewers in the 80s too, I guess. So,
or you had kids tuning in for Kirk Cameron and Emmanuel Lewis.
That's true. I think that was the idea there. You got the Phyllis Diller fans. You got the Webster fans. TV was so different back then. I think I wanted to look back. I've been teasing this. We've talked about Brian's shirts. And they were basically what wardrobe people in the 80s thought kids wore in shirts. This, even in the 90s, like when you saw little kids on Step by Step, they would wear shirts that just said, like, you know, football. Or there was one, I remember this little kid in Step by Step wore a shirt that said Hoopster, and it had a a picture of a basketball. I just think it's just like lame what people think kids wore in the 80s. So we've noticed Brian wearing a lot of these, and I put together a little retrospective, and I took the MIDI version of the Alf theme and slowed it down to 50% to make it more emotional. More emotional, possibly more disturbing. Moto X, remember that one?
Yeah, absolutely.
This one just kind of has a weird button, or like
tag.
Yeah. I don't know what this one is. It looks like it does have the fake collar. Pajamas. Weird. Taxi driver with a little weird button in the middle. Suspenders. 32. A weird sweatsuit.
I think I had one of those.
Yeah. Church clothes, football pajamas,
my favorite.
And sad asparagus. Not a dry eye watching.
Wow. That's one of the things I'll take away from this.
Brian's outfits. And you should see, I've looked ahead at season two. Wow, there's some even nuttier ones. So I don't know. Maybe if we can start a Patreon, we can get season two going. Maybe that would motivate us to do something cool, whether it's the marathon, whether it's a whole other season. The sky's the limit, really, with your support, Melinda's and Rhonda's.
And possibly Welker's, Welkerino's,
I hope Welkeroos. I hope Welker's, Rhonda's, and Melinda's all come together to support us.
And even the 11 people who watched only Frenchie and the Creep.
I like that show. I want that to come back this summer, too.
Oh, God, no. So to round out the first season of Willie's Garage, I was going to try to find like two or three ALF covers to string together.
ALF covers, what do you mean? Like my bedspread here?
No, like people playing their guitar or their saxophone along with it. Instead, I found 8 people playing it on guitar, 6 people playing it on bass, 5 people playing it on drums, 2 on sax, 2 on keyboards, 11 people from folk duos to brass bands, like in multiple groups. And then also I found ukulele, violin, 8-bit, and your favorite, a cappella, and I strung them together into this. This is the very talented people of YouTube playing the ALF theme.
I make Daryl's shirt. Season 2's theme leaned into the sax part. Pretty. In that audience. George, I am blown away. That is incredible. We'll post that separately on the YouTube channel. That must have taken a lot of work to edit. I tip my hat, my ALF hat to you on that one.
It's my gift to you as ALF's biggest fan. And Paul Fusco, that should show you the devotion of the people at Willie's Garage. You don't know how many people are working here behind the scenes. The grips, yeah. The gaffers.
So many people. And I want to say I genuinely got emotional on that because I thought as a kid I watched ALF. I was obsessed with it. And to think that we would have this just support network of, well, mainly you, but just but all the people watching, all the people commenting, making their own ALF art, their songs, sending in their ALF crap. It's really been amazing and fulfilling, and I appreciate everybody who's joined us for this, and especially you, George. Thank you for joining me on this insane journey that's kept me somewhat sane during this pandemic.
Imagine that watching and recapping ALF has been the island of sanity. That shows what our times are like.
It's up is down, left is right. It's a topsy-turvy time, but ALF has been the guiding light for so many. And mainly me. So thanks for watching. We will chime in at some point this summer. And if there's any ELF breaking news that happens, maybe we hear about a reboot, maybe Paul Fusco contacts us, maybe something weird happens, we'll do a mini-sode or something like that. So stay tuned. We're not going anywhere. And thanks so much, everybody. Until we see you again, Bite Wind!
Crashing with his